Good morning and welcome. Isn't this a good-looking choir up here?
Yeah, I think so.
We're going to open the service this morning, and if you would like to join with us in singing, you may. The one thing about this song is it's talking about asking God to bless America. But before that happens, America has got to start blessing God.
Thank you.
As most of you are aware, several weeks we're going to have a series of meetings that we hope will bring revival to our church. Now, I don't call it having a revival. I cannot presume upon God that that will happen. All we can do is prepare our hearts for revival, pray for revival to come, first and foremost within each one of us, and then through our church, then our community, our state, and our nation. We are certainly a nation in need of a revival to God, but we're also a church that is. We're a pretty good church, but we're a church that's not experiencing a manifest power of the Holy Spirit like many. I want to have God move in a great way in my life, the life of my church, the life of my community. I'm not satisfied because God's not satisfied. I would like to share with you a scripture. It's found in Psalm 24. And one thing that keeps us from experiencing the power of God, the way he would like to come down, is this problem. It says, who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false. He will receive a blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Savior. One of the key aspects of experiencing God moving in a powerful way is a clean hand and pure heart. Now, all of us think we're pretty good Christians. You know, I don't think you woke up this morning and go, wow, what a lousy Christian I am. You know, I'm wicked. But the fact is, can any of us say that we have the clean hands and the pure heart that God wants us to have? The first step of the revival is to realize the sin in our lives and be broken before God, begging him to forgive us. And then the process of revival can begin. And we'll be preaching on that a little bit later on today. But ask yourself, do I have clean hands? Do I have a pure heart? What do I need to confess to God? But confession is not enough. We can confess. But if we truly aren't serious with sorrow to turn our life around, it will mean little.
I invite you, if you're able, to stand with us as we sing.
Thank you.
size, several hundred people. They've been doing the Baptist programs like they've been trained to do, and we're reaching people using the Baptist way of building a church. But the pastor sensed that even though they had a pretty good fellowship and a pretty good church, that there was one thing missing: the overwhelming power of God. Because what they were doing had little to do with God. It had more to do with building based on programs that other people said they needed to do. So at Graceland Baptist Church in New Albany, Indiana, Elvis Markham, the pastor, decided that we need God. What we have is fine, but we've done it ourselves. Where's Jesus in what we're doing? So he planned a revival. The evangelists came, and it was a good week or so. The evangelists had to move on, but Elvis Markham sensed that God wanted them to continue. How bad did they want the presence of God? How bad did they want revival? And so he announced that they would continue on, and he would begin the preaching. Where some people went home, they'd done their duty for the revival services. And several days passed, and he preached. And suddenly one night, God moved in a powerful way. Now, he was a traditional Baptist. He was not used to seeing God move in some dramatic way. But God moved in such a way that he found himself on his face before God in the congregation. They felt something that felt like the rush of a mighty wind through the church, but the curtains weren't moving. Joel Reagans, the music director, a nice, good, traditional Baptist with his suit on, saw Elvis fall to his face. What's going on? And then before he knew it, he was on his face too with the overwhelming presence of God. And he peeked out after a few minutes to see almost everyone in the congregation, several hundred people on their face, crying out to God, asking forgiveness of sin. God was moving in a dramatic way. And that continued day after day after day, month after month after month. And today, Graceland Baptist Church is still experiencing the power of God. Thousands come from all over two different states, Kentucky and Indiana, to experience the presence of God at Graceland Baptist Church. Had nothing to do with the pastor. Had nothing to do with Joel Reagans, the music director. Had nothing to do with the people. Had everything to do with the power of God through Jesus Christ. Amen. We need that today in our community. We need that today in our church. We're a pretty good church. But God's not moving. Pretty good group of people. But sin still reigns rather than Jesus. If you have your Bibles, let's take a look at what we need to do to experience the kind of revival that Graceland Baptist Church experienced. 2 Corinthians 7, verses 13, 14, and 15. We have these words. God is speaking to Solomon. Solomon had prayed to God years before, and God did not respond back until this particular passage. And he had this to say to King Solomon in the temple. He said, "When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among the people." Notice the word "when." God was letting us know that we may at one point be on a spiritual high, but over time, almost all of us gradually slide down that mountain and back into the valley. Sometimes it's decided quickly by our own actions and sins, but sometimes we just drift away from God over time. It wasn't planned. We get busy with our lives. Sin sneaks back in. We get dry. We go through the motions of religion, but the vital relationship and power of God is no longer there. And God lets us know ahead of time that's going to happen. It's not what he wants. It's not his perfect will, but that's what is going to happen. And he goes on to say, this is what he's going to do when we drift away from God. This is what he is going to do when we get back in the valley. This is what he's going to do when we get comfortable in that sewage of sin that happens in our lives. He says, "When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people. We see here three different actions that God said he will do when we drift away from him. First of all, he's talking about the land. Now that's obviously, in the time of Solomon, the land of Israel, the people of Israel. Well, today we're the people of God, but he's not talking about geographical property. He's not worried about the land you lived on, or the land I live on, or the farm you live on. Instead, that land means something else. Today, that land is personal. And that's our personal land, our own lives, the land of our lives, what's going on within us. And what he's saying is, when our land gets dry, it's because he has stopped his blessings. But there's another type of land that we are a part of, that we occupy in a spiritual and relational sense. That's our relational land with other people. When we drift away from God, our relational land is affected. Our relationships are affected. And today in this church, there are relationships that are broken, that are fractured. There's unforgiveness. There is judgmentalism going on. And God says, I need to heal that land. But there's more. Also, there's the land of God's kingdom land, the church. Not only do we have issues personally and relationally, our church has issues. God has stopped moving like he wants to in our kingdom land here at First Baptist Church. Now, it's true with many other churches as well, but that's not my responsibility. My responsibility is here, and so is yours as well. And he goes on to say what's going to happen to the land. He says, when there is no rain, because he shuts up the heavens. Now, we just had a pretty good rainstorm last night. So I don't want you to think that this means, well, this doesn't apply to us. Because he's not talking here to us today about physical rain. He's talking about the metaphor of the rain of God's blessings. Because throughout the Bible, there's times when rain is mentioned, but it's not physical rain. It is the rain of God's blessings from heaven. God does not bless us with the overwhelming guidance, power, or joy of his Spirit when we drifted away and broken his heart. The rain has largely stopped spiritually in many of our lives, in the life of our church. But not only are we talking about no rain, he goes on to use another term, when locusts devour. Now again, he's talking about physical locusts. If you've ever seen some TV movie, it's something we don't experience today in the same way. But in Africa today, locusts by the billions will occupy parts of Africa. There's so many that they darken the sky and the sun's blotted out. And they eat everything, every single thing in their path. There's so many, there's nothing you can do about it. Well, I believe today, the locusts today mean the problems and the conflict and the chaos in our lives as a result of God not moving in our own sin that threatens to eat us alive as people. It eats up your joy. It eats up the experience of God in our lives. Locusts are here today devouring. But there's more. He goes on to say that the plague that afflicts, we just recently experienced a plague called COVID-19. Generally, though, we as Americans are pretty safe from that. But if you go to Africa or places in the Middle East, plagues hit regularly, smallpox, dysentery, many other diseases. Well, the plague still means something to us here. But again, it's not physical or biological, it's spiritual. The plague that afflicts us today are the plague of personal problems through our sin that make us sick spiritually. Yes, you may be walking around. You may go to your doctor and say you're in perfect health, but you're sick. You're sick spiritually because of the plague of sin and problems that are going on in your life. And the plague is contagious, just as COVID was. I have a brother-in-law and my sister who had the ability to be able to literally shut themselves up for almost 2 years. They hid in their house like a bunker. They seldom went out. Great. They were very cautious about COVID. But my brother-in-law still got it just a few weeks ago. The plague is out there as far as COVID, but the plague is also out there today, which is the plague of other people's Sin's a dysfunction in our life that afflicts all of us. It's contagious. When I have the plague of sin and problems in my life, it's going to affect people around me, relationally and otherwise. The plague is here. And so often the plague can make the whole situation, whole environment that you're in, toxic for yourself and for others. God is telling us today we have a crisis in our land. The rain has stopped. The locusts are devouring, and the plague afflicts. We need revival in the land. So what's the answer to our problems? Well, it tells us in 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14, which says, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sins and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open, my ears attentive to the prayer offered in this place." So the right response when there's crisis in the land is to turn to God. Now the wrong response is try to turn on each other, blaming everyone else for the problem, or try to solve the problem yourself, the crisis, through self-effort and self-wisdom. And that's so often what happens. We like to point fingers. Well, if Billy Bob over there did his act together, we wouldn't have this problem. If Mary Lou wouldn't quit sinning, we'd be great. Folks, the problem is me, and the problem is you. We've got to realize that we can't blame others, and we can't solve this through some new handy-dandy program that's the latest rage from some denominational authority or religious authority. It's really simple. We need to turn to God. The right response is to turn to Him. It goes on to say, if my people who are called by my name, the right people have to do it. Only people who are owned by God, who are under His authority, who have Jesus Christ in their life, and doing His work His way, only they can do this. If you're an unbeliever, you can cry out to God, but He's not going to necessarily bring you revival until you get right with Him in your own life. If we are truly God's people, we must act. Now understand, in a given church, you've got a long membership list. One pastor said one time, half of any church membership you won't see in heaven. You'll be surprised who doesn't make it. You'll be surprised who does. It's not my job to judge that. All I can say is not everyone sitting in a church on a Sunday morning anywhere is definitely a person of God. It's incumbent upon you, if you are truly of God, you will pray for revival. It goes on to say, my people called by my name. God calls us to a relationship with Him. Some people walk around with the vestiges of Christianity. They kind of look like a Christian. They fool people, they fool themselves, but they truly aren't of God. Only the people called by His name, who have given their lives to Him, are truly His people. And it goes on to say that those people who humble themselves, it comes with the right people having the right attitude. Pride is undue, exaggerated, high opinion of oneself. There's an idol in the church today. There's an idol in the church today, and that's the idol of me. We may not have a physical idol in the corner of our house. We may not burn incense to it. But meism is a contagion in the church today. And it's shown by certain evidences. Judgmentalism, arrogance, always being right, always looking at others as not meeting your personal standards, wanting things your way, not willing to compromise with others for the sake of getting along, unity. Those are just some of the examples of pride. And pride is a problem today in the church. Pride is a problem here at First Baptist Church. Pride is probably a problem with some, if not most of you. We must humble ourselves. That means to let go of our pride and realize we are nothing before the great and mighty God. We are nothing. He is everything. What I think doesn't matter. What you think doesn't matter. All that matters is Jesus Christ and His will in our lives. All that matters is the power of God moving and come and doing His mission in this world to further His kingdom. We got to quit spending so much time looking at one another, judging one another, and get our eyes back on Jesus. And revival can come. We need to have that right attitude, humility. Humility means not only realizing your position before God as you is nothing and Him is everything. That's why we're here. But humility is also putting others before yourself. Concerned about their needs, their feelings over your own. If that's not what you're doing, you have a pride problem. So we need the right people with the right attitude. Then we need the right action to pray and seek God's face. Now, I know I said pray and seek God's face. Some of us go through ritual prayer every day. We may pray before our dinner, a formulaic prayer where we're not really thinking about it. We may pray at various times, something we do every day. But our heart's not really in it. It's just something we do because it's a pattern in our life. The kind of praying that we're talking about is praying to seek God's face, to actively seek to communicate with God and hear God speak, to experience Him in our life. To focus on Him continually, not once in a while. Not give Him a casual glance, but Him be the focus of our lives. That's the prayer we're talking about here. How bad do you want revival in your life? Some of you don't want it that bad. You want revival as long as it doesn't hurt you. You don't feel that brokenness. You don't want revival because it's going to take too much effort. You don't want revival because you have to change some areas in your life. I know I do. But when we're truly praying and seeking God's face, we're seeking to emphasizing to understand Him, to know Him personally, and to follow Him committedly and ultimately in our life. Is God the focus of your life? Not just a focus, not something you think about occasionally. And we need the right action, and then we need a right direction in our lives that has to turn from our wicked ways. Now, when you hear that word wicked, you think of all the other people, right? You think about the people who are shooting people in the streets of New York or Chicago, or raping, or murdering, or doing terrible things with sex. And you're thinking, oh, those are the people who are wicked. Oh, I'm pretty good. But folks, compare it to the Almighty, Holy God. We're wicked. We got to quit rationalizing, minimizing, or ignoring the sin in our life, both individually and as a church. We need to repent. Now, that's not a popular word today. Sometimes it's not uttered in churches because it's so old-fashioned, it's obsolete. Repent, that sounded like something from an 1880s revival meeting. Repent simply means to express, to feel deep sorrow for your sin. And have a serious commitment to turn your life from that sin, from your own control of your life, our wicked ways, into God. You can pray, but if you don't truly turn from your wicked ways, your prayers will go nowhere and will mean nothing. And then God gives us a gracious promise. When we turn from our wicked ways, it goes on to say, then I will hear from heaven. He's listening. Now, heaven represents not only where God's presence is, because He's also present here, but it also represents the superiority, authority, power, and lordship over our life. You know, on TV, occasionally I'll hear someone about, yeah, God's my buddy, the man upstairs. No, He's not. He's no man upstairs. He's not your buddy. He's the Almighty God. He is your friend. But more importantly, He's your Lord. Though God may sometimes seem distant to us, way up in heaven, somewhere past the Milky Way galaxy, when individuals, churches, and people rebel against Him, He's seeing it. He's always ready to hear, though, from us, from heaven. And it goes on to say, when we humble ourselves, we seek His face and pray, and we turn from our wicked ways, then He will forgive our sin. No matter how serious your sin is, God will forgive us. He will no longer hold it against us. It's not a debt that He holds against us. Against us as people, against our church, against our nation. Now, some of us are carrying around some pretty heavy-duty sin that you've done in the past. And you feel guilty about it. Others are looking at some in the church going, well, he's a real sinner. Well, folks, I got news for you. If he's gone to God, seek his face, turn from his wicked ways or her from wicked ways, that sin no longer is an account. And we got to quit judging people for what they've done in the past and celebrate what is going on in the present and what he will do in the future. There should never be a list. There should never be a list. There should never be a list of people who you have decided aren't good enough, aren't spiritual enough. Because if there's a list, you need to be on it in the first spot. We are a church that judges too much. Probably all of them do. Baptists are kind of bad about that. You know, we got that Pharisee thing going pretty well. But we need to understand that when someone is forgiven, no matter what they've done in the past, it may be 20 years of sin, once they've asked forgiveness and they've turned their life around, they are born again, they are clean, and you need to let it go.
Amen.
He wants to forgive us. The magnitude of this forgiveness is so amazing that Jesus died on the cross to make it happen so the Father can forgive. If God did that for us, why can't we forgive each other? Why can't we sometimes forgive ourselves? No matter what sin you've done in the past, if you give that to God, ask forgiveness, it's gone. Whatever guilt you continue to feel is Satan trying to influence you, to neutralize you. And it goes on to say, then God will heal our land. God's forgiveness unleashes God's supernatural, overwhelming power to bless and heal our lives and our church, our society, even our nation. We can experience revival again. Remember verse 15. Right now, it says, now, right this moment, my eyes are open and my ears attentive to the prayers in this place. He's ready. 1949, the Spirit of God moved in a mighty way in an area of Scotland called the Hebrides. It's a series of islands. It's been called the Hebrides Revival, the Lewis Awakening. One man in particular, a Scottish preacher, by the name of Duncan Campbell, was used powerfully by God. One day while he was preaching in his church, God says, it's time to leave, go to the countryside. He heeded that voice, not knowing what was going to happen. At that time, Scotland was at a spiritual decline, like America is today. The churches were empty of anyone under the age of 45 or 50. The area was spiritually bankrupt. The place where you find the revival is the tavern, not the church. God was an afterthought to many people. Duncan Campbell went to preach through that area. Understand, revival can be messy. That's going to bother some of us. We like some nice, neat, clean, organized things. We like things that we can control that make sense to us. But when God moves, folks, sometimes it's messy. When Duncan Campbell began preaching, not knowing what God had in store, it was amazing. By the thousands, people were saved. But folks, not many were actually saved when he was preaching. The Spirit moved so powerfully, people would be walking down the road, and God would hit them, and the Spirit would move. And these are people just as hard-hearted and cold as the people that we know today that are not saved. And they'd find themselves on their knees and then on their face, right there in the middle of the road. There's no preacher, there's no angelic choir, there's no hymns being sung. God moved, and 75% of the people, according to the experts, were saved that way. Not in revival meetings. They were saved because the Spirit moved. Now, I don't know about you, but I find it hard to believe. I've never seen that. I find it so fantastic. When I originally heard these stories, I'm going, yeah, right. Yeah, sure. That doesn't happen. But after my research through multiple sources, I began to realize it was a fact. In one small village that Duncan Campbell went to preach, and he wasn't the only one used. They had a couple of services, but God's breakthrough didn't happen. So they had a meeting one night, and one of the elders of and pray. And after a couple of hours of praying, an uneducated blacksmith was there, and he asked to pray. And that blacksmith began to pray and says, God, we need you, we need revival. He goes, I challenge you, Lord, to come down and move in this place. Duncan Campbell was shocked. How can you talk to God that way? We need you, Lord. We expect you to move. And at that moment, Duncan Campbell says that the house shook like an earthquake. And they found themselves on their face. Duncan Campbell didn't know how long it was, but it turned out to be a couple hours as God moved in that midst of that small prayer meeting of village elders. And then they walked out at 1:30 in the morning. They noticed in the village just down the road, all the lights were on. People were woken up by the Spirit of God. People who were nominal Christians at best. And the Spirit bid them right there at that moment at 1:30 in the morning to go, to meet, to experience God. And so people start coming up to Duncan Campbell and the elders and saying, where's the meeting? I'm here for the meeting. No invitation went out. It was a spontaneous movement of God. And revival broke out that night in that little village. Now, Duncan Campbell's not some wild-eyed, charismatic type that we expect something like that from. He was a Presbyterian. Now, if you think we Baptists can be a little cold, you know, you ain't seen nothing until you've experienced Presbyterians. They're called the Frozen Chosen. Duncan Campbell had never experienced anything like this in his ministry until he went out with the calling of God in 1949. At a time of spiritual lowness in the whole country of the United Kingdom. In one situation, there was a dance going on with young people. There was a revival meeting going on down the road where the churches Duncan Campbell was preaching at. And the story's told and confirmed by multiple sources, I heard myself, that suddenly in that dance where the people were having a good time, I don't know how they danced in 1949, the Spirit moved. And all the young people there, teens and early 20s, felt led right there, spontaneously. No one talked to them about it. Felt led to head out the door and head to the church. Duncan Campbell said they were singing when suddenly dozens, if not hundreds, of young people filled the church. Standing room only. He couldn't even get to the pulpit because of the crowd of young people. He asked them, what are you doing here? He goes, we don't know. God called us to be here. These were hard, cold, hard-hearted people. But when the Spirit of God moves, you don't have a chance. I want to experience revival like that at First Baptist Church. I want to experience revival like that in Houston, Missouri. I want to experience revival like that in the country of the United States of America. Because, folks, that's our only hope. We need healing in our land. How bad do you want revival? In a couple of weeks, we're going to have services. But actually, the process starts now. If we wait till that first night, probably nothing will happen. Do you want revival? Do you want revival in your life? Do you want revival in the life of this church? It begins with each one of us. As we follow what God said, as my people who are called by my name, that they humble themselves and pray and seek his face, and turn from their wicked ways, then and only then will I hear and heal their land. Are you ready for revival? Are you ready? Let's stand as God speaks to us today. Maybe you would like to come up and pray for revival to begin, but begin with you first and foremost in our church. Do some business with the Lord. Get right with God, whatever that might be, whatever sins in your life are, the sin of pride, arrogance, sexual sin, whatever it might be. It's time to get right with God and experience revival today. As we have this invitation song, what does God want you to do as we sing?